at UCL and also our copyright officer, so I was interested in the discussion about copyright in relation to data and the ordering of data in databases. What Anthony's asked me to talk about, and which I'm going to talk about for the next 30 minutes, is the work that Cliff and I were involved with in the Blue Ribbon Task Force on Economically Sustainable Digital Preservation, and the reports and recommendations that we produced in the course of 2 years of work looking at this question. And what I'm going to do is quite straightforward. I'm going to explain a little bit about the background to the task force, who was on it, what the purpose of setting it up was, what the principles were that we worked on. I'm going to spend most of the talk looking at the report in a bit more detail and trying to tease out some of the issues in the very detailed recommendations that we made, and then very briefly suggest some next steps about how the recommendations in the report can be or are being taken forward. It really is a charge to the community, as opposed to a report with recommendations that can simply be implemented. And I think that's something I'd like to explore in next steps. So anyway, I should thank straight away Brian Lavoy from OCLC, who was our co-chair on the task force. And he is giving a similar presentation at our annual the LIBA conference in Aarhus in Denmark next week, which some of us are attending. LIBA is the European Association of Research Libraries, and Brian has very kindly let me copy one or two of his diagrams to flesh out this talk. So let's go to the background and see why the task force needed to be set up. And basically, this is one of the core issues that was the driver for the funders, particularly the National Science Foundation in the US, to set the task force up. And the slide tries to capture the feeling that, for example, in 2007, the amount of digital information created, captured, or replicated exceeded available storage capacity. And you see this on the lines in the diagram here. The dark blue line here is the amount of information created. Is it blue? It's blue. Oh, it's purple on the screen, right, okay. And the orange line down here in Brian's diagram is the amount of available storage. So clearly the problem is in this area here, the mismatch between that endpoint and this endpoint here. That's the problem that we're trying to deal with, because in order to tackle that challenge, you need to decide what is preserved and what is not. You need to accommodate your schema to the IPR environment, and as Wilma was explaining earlier this afternoon, there is a decided copyright IPR environment around the arrangement and storage of data, as opposed to the raw data itself, which carries in itself no copyrights. And we have to match our means to our ends, what we're able to do with what we want to do. And that was the charge that the task force set out to tackle. It was supported mainly by the National Science Foundation in the States, by Mellon, by the Library of Congress, by JISC here in the UK, by CIR, and by NARA in the US. Our co-chairs, as I explained, were Brian Lavoy from OCLC and Fran Behrman as well, who was for most of her time at San Diego Supercomputer Center in California when she was with us on the task force. The idea was that it was cross-domain and cross-discipline, so I was there, I was honored to be there and nominated by the JISC as a library representative, not someone who's very knowledgeable about the technical issues around digital preservation, but someone very interested in the policy and strategy issues around digital preservation. So that was the experience and the interest that I tried to bring to the task force. There were two European members on the task force, both nominated by the JISC in the UK, myself and Chris Rusbridge, who was then director of the Digital Curation Centre. We issued an interim report in December 2008, and this set the baseline. It expanded on the challenges and tried to map what work had been done to address those challenges by the time the report was issued at Christmas 2008. And the final report was issued in February this year, which came up with the recommendations and a roadmap for further work, which is the work I'm going to come on and describe. The report was launched twice this year, once in Washington on the 1st of April at a national conversation with stakeholders and policymakers at the Fairmont Hotel in Washington, looking at the economic sustainability of digital preservation. And here in the UK, in the Wellcome Trust building, in a national conference led by the JISC on the 6th of May. This is the final report, the Year 2 report, and all the documents that I've alluded to, and a lot of the contextual documentation as well, is available at this. Not at this URL, because obviously that's the URL of the report, but in the task force website, at the start of that URL, you'll find all the contextual information as well as the report that I'll be referring to in the rest of the slides.
If you Google it in this country, you get to the GIST site, and it's quite easy. In fact, the GIST site is really a better way to go through.
Right,
it's
okay.
Clearer.
It's been reorganised, so it's very clear. Thank you.
No, not the GIST site as such, I'm talking about. If you Google, you get GIST.
Perfect. Yeah. Thanks for that, Anthony.
That's better.
The key message which dictated the way in which we worked was facilitated by Brian, if I can give him that honour, by proposing working with the task force and then teasing out what we have put down here as a definition of what economically sustainable digital preservation actually means. We spent a lot of the first year it took quite a bit of work to boil it down to this statement: what is economically sustainable digital preservation? And working with Brian, we came to this working definition that we adopted for the final report. Sustainable economics for digital preservation is not just about finding more money. And if you work in the UK, you'll know, as the previous government told us, there is no more money anyway. So it's not about finding money, it's about building an economic activity to underpin digital preservation that's firmly rooted in a compelling value proposition about why you want to do it, why it needs to be done in the first place, with clear incentives to act, drivers to make you want to do it, and well-defined preservation roles and responsibilities. So it's a rather complex equation where all those parts have to be present and balanced in a rather happy equilibrium. And once you have all those elements in place, you might be able to say that you have identified a way to sustain economically the digital preservation activity that you're undertaking. And this definition of economically sustainable digital preservation underpins most of the thinking in the final report. And it's to the final report and the recommendations that the challenge to society to take the issues further, which is really what the report is, that I'll turn to now. And one of the things we did, one that I found most interesting in the final report, is to look at four actual case studies in terms of digital preservation context and work through some of the generic issues we identified. For example, the definition of what economically sustainable digital preservation is. We worked through them in these four areas: scholarly discourse, scholarly communication, conventional scholarly communication, as well as new forms of communication. Research data, commercially owned cultural content, and we'd had a lot of input from Hollywood, actually, from the movie industry in Hollywood, and that was fascinating in the conversation in Washington. I'm not going to say more about it today, unfortunately, because I won't have time, but to hear them talk about their own concept and lack of, if I may say this, lack of clarity about who was responsible for digitally preserving their output. We had the director from Avatar there, and he admitted, well, we don't think we're responsible for digitally preserving Avatar. In fact, technically, we don't know how we would do it. All we're interested in is producing the film and making the money. I can paraphrase for conciseness. And then it's not our problem to digitally preserve it. So there is no strategy for digitally preserving a film like Avatar from that sector. And that was quite revealing. And the fourth area of content that we looked at is collectively produced web content. And if you read the report, which I'm sure you have done or will do, you'll see the recommendations in all these areas based on the work in the of the two-year task force. I'm going to concentrate on two, because they're areas I feel more comfortable with personally, being a university librarian coming from the academic sector. I'm going to say a little bit more about scholarly discourse and research data. And again, let me emphasise that the way we tackle these case studies is to go back to our definition of economically sustainable digital preservation and be guided by the principles that were embedded in that statement. So we need to articulate a compelling value proposition, why you should undertake digital preservation of this content at all, what the incentives are to preserve for the public interest, and can you define the roles and responsibilities amongst the stakeholders, like who does what and who pays for what. So scholarly discourse, apologies for the block of text, I'm not going to go through this. Of all the areas that we, well, not going through it in great detail, of all the areas that we looked at, this we felt was the most mature because it had well-developed preservation and funding strategies as a legacy of the print world, which could, in theory, be carried over into the digital world, although they may not scale. There was at least a baseline to work from. We identified areas where there needed to be clarification, and we identified roles and responsibilities. So, for example, research and education institutions, professional societies, publishers, libraries, and scholars all have roles to play in creating the digital preservation context and the digital preservation strategies for the materials that are valuable to them. So it was not a case of saying the responsibility can be pushed or allocated to one stakeholder alone. It was seen as a collaborative effort with all the stakeholders having a role to play. And the recommendations for this type of material that the report came up with are these: that library scholars and professional societies should develop selection criteria for emerging genres in scholarly discourse and prototype preservation and access strategies to support them, to make sure we can do it, and to make sure we can pay for it. That publishers who reserve the right to preserve, if that is a condition of the license, should in fact partner with third-party archives or libraries to guarantee or to ensure long-term preservation. There was some doubt that publishers alone would be able to fulfill the role of providing long-term digital preservation and access to the content. So there was a suggestion, a plea, that they should party with third parties to ensure that their role is the requirement to digitally preserve and ensure long-term access could be successfully performed. The third recommendation in this genre was that scholars should consider granting non-exclusive rights to publish and preserve, explicitly to preserve, and not only to publish, but to preserve, to enable decentralised and distributed preservation of emerging scholarly discourse. And that would be a new development, a change in the way that authors currently deal with publishers or with other bodies to disseminate their work. The emphasis tends to be on access and not preservation, but preservation is really long-term access. It's irresponsible to make something accessible if you can't guarantee access to it in the long term. That's what digital preservation is, it's long-term access. And so scholars have an enormously important role to play in taking control of the material that they're creating and helping to ensure that long-term access is possible. There was a recommendation for libraries, particularly to look at their roles and responsibilities in preserving monographs and new emerging scholarly genres along the lines similar to those of e-journals. And we looked at models of good practice in the e-journal arena, models like eDepot in the Netherlands, the Portico service run from the US, as models of good practice for digital preservation of journal material. We noted that these were largely or significantly influenced by libraries, so libraries had a role to extend that range of interest to cover new forms of material, and we particularly felt they should start with e-books. And we noted that while open access is a strategy which receives great support in developed countries, we wanted to emphasise that all open access strategies that assume a persistence of information over time, which clearly they do, because that's what open access means, these must consider provisions for the funding of preservation, not simply of access. And if these conditions were not met, you wouldn't have met the dictates of the definition of economically sustainable digital preservation that we had laid out as our goal and aspiration at the start of the report. So those were the recommendations for scholarly discourse. I'm going to look at one more type, maybe go through it a little bit quicker. And this is research data, and we've heard a lot about research data this afternoon. Clearly, research data is becoming increasingly important and increasingly visible. There's a high recognition of the benefits of preserving research data. But unlike the scholarly discourse arena, we noted very few robust systems for making decisions about what to preserve. And there is often, as I would suggest, very often, a lack of coordination of roles, responsibilities, and funding sources that would support any preservation activity. So it's very fragmented, it's not thought through, and therefore it's highly susceptible to failure. And that's a concern, clearly a concern. So the recommendations for research data that the task force made, each domain through professional societies or other consensus-making bodies, should set priorities for data selection, the level of curation, and the length of retention. Do you have to retain everything forever, or are there categories into which you can slot different types of data? Funders should impose preservation mandates when appropriate. When mandates are imposed, funders should also specify selection criteria, the funding that can be used to support the mandate, and the responsible organisations who can provide the archiving activity. Funding agencies should explicitly recognise data under stewardship as a core indicator of scientific effort and include this information in standard reporting mechanisms. And we felt that because this is a new area and one could think afresh, preservation services should reduce curation, should in theory reduce curation and archiving costs by leveraging economies of scale wherever possible. And again, a similar recommendation to deal with third-party archiving activity. Those were the recommendations for two of the four data genre types that we looked at, but a big part of the report is really about considering the issues of digital preservation as a challenge not only to the information creators, but to society as a whole. It is a society. It is a matter which concerns the whole of society if you are interested in creating a knowledge economy, in preserving the creation of scholarly output, of scientific output, of artistic output. And so if you think that digital preservation works in that context, then clearly it has challenges for the whole of society. And we tried to identify at the level of society, as opposed to the individual domains, what the issues were. We thought that all parts of society have roles in achieving sustainability, and that leadership is needed at all levels of society. And so we likewise presented a summary of the action agendas for these major stakeholders at a society level. And so the report recommends organisational action. How do you get to the position where you're able to deliver on economically sustainable digital preservation using the formula, the definition that we set at the start of the report? And in terms of organisations, these are some of the suggestions that we made. Developing public-private partnerships, achieving economies of scale and scope. There were technical actions which we thought at a society level were needed, building capacity to support stewardship in all areas was one of the recommendations we made here. And the ones that particularly interested me, because this is the area that I'm particularly interested in, is the area of public policy. How does public policy need to develop and change in order to create the environment where economically sustainable digital preservation is possible? You can modify the copyright laws to enable digital preservation. You can create incentives and requirements for private entities to preserve on behalf of the public. And there was a particular feeling, the last bullet on that slide, empowering, you should be able to empower stewardship organisations to protect orphan and digital orphan works from an unacceptable loss. And we spent quite a bit of time looking at the problem of orphan works and how to tackle them in a preservation environment, because if you cannot trace the rights, who then has the right to preserve? And if you don't have the right to preserve, does that automatically mean that the orphan work is going to be lost? And we made some recommendations for education and public outreach. So, my final slides. What next? We issue a report, we make recommendations analysing the context in which economically sustainable digital preservation can work. How are those challenges taken up? The report really is a challenge to society and to all stakeholders concerned with creating and making digital information available, to take the issue seriously and to act in terms of the work that they can do as a stakeholder in their own particular area. One of the things we did do when the report was being launched in Washington in April is to make a submission to the Grand Challenge from President Obama's office and the US Office of Science and Technology. They were following the work that we were doing on the report, and they asked us to make a submission, a policy submission, to the Obama administration for consideration for implementation in future legislative and policy announcements. And so what we did over a few days, it had to be done fairly quickly because the deadline was very tight, we made some recommendations to the US government about what they could do to take the agenda forward. For Chris and myself, who are British, work in the UK, I could never see this working in the UK. I can't imagine anyone from the British government coming to say, tell me what you would do to make digital preservation easier. I think in the economic environment we live in, that's not very likely to happen anytime soon. Nor, I have to say, anywhere in the rest of Europe, because someone who has to deal with the Commission fairly frequently, I can't imagine anyone from the European Commission coming to ask the same question either. But in the US they did. That was the first question they asked. Tell us what we can do to make things better. And so we made some suggestions to what the federal government could do. They could stimulate research and development and the development of necessary technical infrastructure to enable digital preservation to take place. They could stimulate the development of human infrastructure, for example, by creating fellowship programmes for cross-disciplinary initiatives in these areas to raise awareness and to skill professionals with the required skills to do the work. The area that I was particularly interested in, they could develop a policy infrastructure which would help embed our definition of economically sustainable digital innovation into the environment. And all the recommendations here in the bullets are about creating financial incentives and developing policies and procedures for best practice that can be adopted by those who are undertaking roles and responsibilities in terms of undertaking digital curation. So if you have been, thank you for listening. And I hope that we hope that the Task Force report is a roadmap and a challenge for future action. Thank you very much.
Now, have we any questions for clarification? Yes, Wilma.
Just a full question. You say one of the possible actions is addressing the free rider problem.
Yes.
Because I knew so.
Yes.
What do you mean by that?
Yes.
You passed over that one, I know, just quickly.
Well, it's not an area that we went into in great detail. And that what was the principle that was that lays behind what we're saying is that everyone has a role and a responsibility to ensure that digital preservation takes place, is funded, and can be paid for. And therefore, everyone who has data to be curated, or scholarly discourse to offer, or websites to be archived, has to have a role and a responsibility and a financial responsibility to ensure that happens. And they cannot piggyback on activity that other people will fund, a commercial body, could not piggyback on activity that the public sector was funding and expect to enjoy the same benefits for no expenditure. That's what we meant by the free rider problem.
Thank you. You've got one question, Stefan.
Yeah, I got a very naive technical question.
Oh, I'm not a technical person.
One of the first slides, you say that the information volume produced today exceeds available storage.
Yes.
How can that be? What happens to the exceeding information?
I'm going to ask Cliff because he's more technical than I am.
Well, actually, it's not. It's not really a technical issue. You need to look at the definitions they used in those reports, which are very peculiar, and deal with. Information that's produced sometimes of a very transient nature. So they're looking at bandwidth transiting networks, they're looking at broadcast communications of various kinds, television, radio. Not all of that's being saved, and there's a very high level of repetition as well.
It could be taken away that the intelligence agencies aren't yet able to record every single phone call that we make. That's information.
That's all,
Well, they can record them, but they can't keep them, you know, they just kind of stream.
That's right. I got one minute, I can say this, I was present at the rollout of this from the UK, and I have actually read this. It isn't too difficult to read. It's only, 32 pages long? It's not very long, anyhow.
Brevity, less is more.
If anybody had looked at the Berkeley report, which somebody mentioned the other day, that is quite unnecessarily verbose. And it's 720
from the study for the Center of Higher Ed?
Yes.
Yes,
that's 728 pages. And it reflects, to my mind, a very woolly attitude as well. But I mean, this one is good. And the recommendations are very clear. They involve publishers quite a bit. The whole report is written in an extremely sensible way. It's a pity that GIST didn't invite publishers to their rollout.
You meant, yeah, I think you made that point.
I know, I made
that
point. But it is, it's good stuff. I mean, I think it's very good stuff.
But I think it's the, it's, it sets the baseline for future activity.
Yeah, I agree.
If people will grasp the nettle and actually take the agenda forward. That's what we wanted the report to do.
To
be a challenge.
Yeah, yeah. And of course it is American, and almost every major publisher I know actually does exactly what the report recommends, particularly the Portico.
Okay.
So but that it's a great, it's a good, it's a really good report. I think they're really grateful for you coming forward.
Thank you for asking me.
And could you come forward, Cliff?